Good evening. We gather here this evening at the end of our Lenten journey to create within ourselves the experience of our Lord's Last Supper, as well as to commemorate the very first celebration of this liturgy. On this holy night, we begin the Easter Triduum, the threefold celebration of Passion, Death, and Resurrection. As we experience the gestures, processions, scripture, readings, music, and rituals in the time that lies ahead, let us pray that we'll be drawn deeply into the proclamation of the Paschal mystery. At the conclusion of our liturgy, as the Blessed Sacrament will be taken to the altar of repose, at that time, we ask you to remain in reflection as the sanctuary and altar are stripped. After the altar is stripped, you are welcome to spend some time in adoration for the Blessed Sacrament until 10 p.m., at which time we will have night prayer. Our liturgy will follow the printed programs that were distributed at the entrance of the church. We invite you to participate sincerely in this liturgy as we watch and pray for some time with our Lord. Our gathering hymn is Lift High the Cross, found in the We Celebrate hymnal number 817. Please stand as we begin our liturgy.
Thank you. Nash, I guess you can hear me now, the retired pastor from St. Faustina, and a native of St. Aloysius. So very good to be here, very beautiful to be here. So let's begin our celebration. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And the grace and the peace of God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. But again, we are reminded in a very beautiful, dramatic way of how much love God has for each one of us to be able to do what he did on that first Good Friday, to offer his life for us, each one of us individually. And so our response has to be always, what do we get back? We want to get back the best we can, the best person we are, all the things that God wants us to grow into. So again, we place all that before our God, confident of God's mercy and forgiveness. Lord Jesus, you raise us to new life. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you forgive us our sins. Christ, have mercy. And Lord Jesus, you feed us with your body and your blood. Lord, have mercy. And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us all to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
most sacred supper, in which your only begotten Son, when about to hand himself over to death, entrusted to the Church a sacrifice new for all eternity, the banquet of his love. Grant, we pray, that we may draw from so great a mystery the fullness of charity and of life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall stand at the head of your calendar. You shall reckon it the first month of the year. Tell the whole community of Israel, on the 10th of this month, every one of your families must procure for itself a lamb, one apiece for each household. If a family is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join the nearest household in procuring one and shall share in the lamb, in proportion to the number of persons who partake of it. The lamb must be a year old male and without blemish. You may take it from either the sheep or the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. And then, with the whole assembly of Israel present, it shall be slaughtered during the evening twilight. They shall take some of its blood and apply it to the two doorposts and the lintel of every house in which they partake of the lamb. That same night, they shall eat of its roasted flesh with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. This is how you are to eat it: with your loins girt, sandals on your feet, and your staff in hand. You shall eat it like those who are in flight. It is the Passover of the Lord. For on the same night I will go through Egypt, striking down every firstborn of the land, both man and beast, and executing judgment on all the gods of Egypt, I, the Lord. But the blood will mark the houses where you are. Seeing the blood, I will pass over you. Thus, when I strike the land of Egypt, no destructive blow will come upon you. This day shall be a memorial feast for you, which all your generations shall celebrate with pilgrimage to the Lord as a perpetual institution." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was handed over, took bread, and after he had given thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also the cup, after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes." The word of the Lord.
Thank you, dear God. Before the feast of Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to pass from this world to the Father. He loved his own in the world, and he loved them to the end. The devil had already induced Judas, son of Simon, and Iscariot to hand him over. So during supper, fully aware that the Father had put everything into his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God, he rose from supper, took off his outer garment. He took a towel and tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and dry them with the towel around his waist. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Master, are you going to wash my feet?" And Jesus answered and said to him, "What I am doing you do not understand now, but you will understand later." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." And Jesus answered him, "Unless I wash you, you will have no inheritance with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Master, then not only my feet, but my hands and head as well." Jesus said to him, "Whoever has bathed has no need except to have his feet washed, for he is clean all over. So you are clean, but not all." For he knew who would betray him. For this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." So when he had washed the feet and put his garments back on and reclined, reclined at table again, he said to them, "Do you realize what I have done for you? You call me teacher and master, and rightly so, for indeed I am. If I therefore, the teacher and the master, have washed your feet, you ought to wash one another's feet. I have given you a model to follow, so that as I have done for you, you should also do." The Gospel of the Lord.
"This is my body."
This is my body. And then he took the wine. And the wine also at the Seder has a special prayer. And he said, this is my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant. So you know that he's there for a very special purpose, and that is to celebrate the Passover, but to celebrate a new Passover, the new and the eternal Passover. Now, if you notice at the description that the Gospel writer gave us this evening, there's something missing at the end. At the meal, we picked it up. What was missing was the lamb. Every Seder had a lamb, which we sacrificed, killed, in other words, and the blood of the lamb placed over the doorpost of your home or wherever you are, and the angel of death would pass over. Where they come from, pass over, they would know that. And it had to be an unblemished lamb, which means that bones cannot be broken. Now, the Gospel of John is interesting. John is the fourth Gospel. It was written the latest of all. And John was a young kid when Jesus was there, but he grew up a little bit, and he began to meditate on this whole mystery that Jesus proclaimed that night of his passion. And he noticed something in the crucifixion story that the other writers apparently missed, but it was something. He picked it up. He said, you know, you remember the story? The Jews wanted the bodies of these three guys taken down for the Passover. And so they wanted them to die. And as long as they could push up on their legs, they could breathe enough to stay alive. So if you broke their legs, they couldn't push up any longer. And they would die. So they went to the two thieves. And they found out that they were still alive. So they broke their legs. And they immediately died. But when they went to Jesus, they found out he was already dead, and they did not break his legs. Now, John picked up on that. This is why I love John's Gospel. He picked up on that. That's because Jesus is in the new, unblemished Lamb of God. Beautiful, beautiful story. So every time we gather for Mass, we gather to celebrate the new Passover, which we don't call the Mass. But you know, you heard on Palm Sunday, we'll hear you tomorrow. Sometimes we sanitize the crucifixion. You know what I mean? We make it nice. It wasn't nice. It wasn't nice in any way. It was the most horrible, relentless punishment that any human being could ever endure. And the Romans did it on purpose so that they could make an example out of people. It was not a good thing. And they would, before they actually got to the cross, they would be scourged. They're whipped in the back and pull the flesh off, put a crown of thorns in his head, bleeding, and then have to carry the cross all the way through the city of Jerusalem to the Mount of the Crucifixion. And then get stretched out, shoulders disordered, nails through his palms or maybe through his wrist. Imagine what that was like. And then his feet nailed to the cross. The new, unblemished Passover lamb. And in the Passover, the Jews placed the blood of the lamb on the doorpost. The blood on that cross was that blood that he's placing there. And so what I'm trying to say is, this is a beautiful moment that we have here when we come to Mass. Whether it's a daily Mass or a week formal Mass like now, it is because of that. And how often do people say, this is just right, that's, I'm not even thinking, but it says, I don't do anything on the Mass, it's boring. I'm thinking, how in the name of God can you say it's boring? After what Jesus did to make it happen, stand at the hang up there for 6 hours, excruciating pain, blood pouring from him, to make this gift possible. And people say, oh, it's boring. It's amazing, isn't it? I don't know how anybody can even say that. Or how many people have not come to the circle anymore after all that Jesus did, all that he endured on that mat, all for us. Now, every time we come to Mass, we renew that. Jesus isn't dying again. He died once for all of us, each one of us. But every time we come to Mass, whether it's tonight or any Mass you come to, it's that sacrificial moment being appropriated just for us. It's almost like we are at the foot of the cross, that we are watching Jesus die. We are watching that. He's not dying again. He's died once. But that death transcends time and space. And that's what happens when we come to Mass. And once again, get in touch with him. I don't know what the word would be, but in touch with him. Now, why did he do all this? Why not this a commandment? He said, I give you a new commandment, that you have to love one another as I have loved you. That's the commandment. In John's Gospel, John doesn't tell us that we'll take a bread and wine and say the Lord's consecration. He does it, he'll reenact it. He said, it's not enough just to receive Christ. It's not enough to do everything liturgically correct. It's not enough. It has to go beyond that. We have to be people of love. People of love. And I don't know, sometimes I've been saying this for a long time. How many people in your life do you have a hard time loving? I'll bet you do. Because I do. And so what are we supposed to do about that? How are we supposed to fulfill that commandment? I read somewhere, I don't know where it was, but it said, Jesus' definition of love is this, to will the good of another. Now, we don't do that in our world. Everything is revenge and hatred and the back at you, I'll get back at you, and never going to forgive you, and all this kind of stuff we hear all the time. And there are people you may just think, I'm sorry, Jesus, but I can't love that person after what he or she did to me. And that's understandable, really. But you say, I'm going to will the good for that person. I'm going to will the good for that person. Not revenge, not anger, not get back at it, but will the good of that person. And Jesus didn't just, you know, pontificate these things from a pulpit and say, this is what I want you all to do. He was out there doing it. Just think of some of the things that have happened in this story. For one thing, we had the beautiful, poignant story of Judas, who betrayed Jesus for the money. I don't know if it was money or not, but he betrayed him. And if you notice, these little details of the Gospel are so profound. Before Judas left that table, he said to Judas, dip your bread in my cup. I learned in the seminary that these little details are noticed, which is there to fill up the page. What did that mean? He said, even though Judas, I know, after we've been together for 3 years, I know you're betraying me. I know you're going to turn me over to the Romans, but I still love you. And so I want you to change. I want you to dip your bread in my cup. That's what he said. And of course, Judas goes off with a kiss. What about the story of Peter? He's a guy that Jesus made the head of the church, the first pope, so to speak, and depended on him to lead the church. And he said to Jesus, you know, you remember he was at the transfiguration, he saw Jesus transformed, you know, all that. And he said, I'll never betray you, Jesus. I will be with you no matter what. And he's standing out there in the crowd with Jesus up on the balcony being tried. And somebody says to him, Peter, you're with that guy, aren't you? He said, no, three times that happened. What about all the apostles except James and of course the women who split, they weren't around? That must have hurt. When you're depending on friends to be with you at the moment when you need somebody and they're not there. So anyway, all that happened and lots more, but after the resurrection, he goes into the upper room where these people are gathered, and they're all thinking, oh boy, here he comes. He's going to give it to us. But for what we did, we're finished. And what does he do when he walks into that room? I know what I would have done. Was it, what do you mean, Barabbas? What do you mean, Barabbas? Why not me? Why'd you betray me? Jerks. Good thing I wasn't Jesus, right? What did he say? He said, peace. Peace. an amazing, amazing, amazing peace. Wishing them good. There's a wonderful song out. I know you're probably a little panicked over it, I'm not going to sing it. But it's written by Andrew Lloyd Webber. If you ever have a chance to look it up online, it's called Love Changes Everything. Love changes everything. I'm not going to do it all, but there's a few lines of that. Love changes everything. How you live and how you die. Love can make a summer fly or a night seem like a lifetime. Yes, love changes everything. Now I tremble at your name. Nothing in the world will ever be the same. And just to skip a few more lines of this. All the rules we make are broken. Yes, love changes everyone. Live or perish, it is final. Love will never let you be the same. Love will never, ever let you be the same. And think about it, it is so true. Our world says if somebody does something to you, you get back at it. Don't ever forgive, get revenge. We hear this so many times, everybody. And it's not the gospel. Love changes everything. And Jesus at the Last Supper showed how much he wants people less love. He got up, took off the outer garment, got a bowl of water, and washed their feet. And by the way, this is a very nice ceremony we're going to have tonight. Very beautiful. It wasn't that beautiful when he did it. But they didn't wear shoes like we were. They wore open sandals on a dirt road with potholes, kind of like people would say that, but with potholes. And so his feet were dirty, their feet were dirty, probably smelly, and he washed their feet. And then he said, as I have done for you, you must do for one another. So as we wash the feet tonight, I want to ask you to do something. Think of somebody in your life who needs his or her foot washed today because of some difficulty. Or think of yourself, maybe you need someone and make that the prayer of this beautiful moment as we wash the feet of our disciples.
Thank you. For the body of Christ that is the church, that the Eucharist may strengthen and nourish us in our mission to follow the model Jesus gave us at the Last Supper. Let us pray to the Lord. For our political leaders, that they may remain aware that they were elected to serve, let us pray to the Lord. For all those whose work involves serving others, that the rest of us may recognize the value and the dignity of the work they do, let us pray to the Lord. For all our prayers, spoken and unspoken, for the sick and the homebound, and for all those in our special intention book near our cross, let us pray to the Lord. For all those who minister to those who are sick, injured, or dying, for those who work in emergency care, hospitals, nursing homes, and hospice care, let us pray to the Lord. For our entire parish community, that we may be renewed in spirit as we celebrate the Paschal Triduum, let us pray to the Lord. For all who have died in Christ, for Nell Corella, for whom this Mass is being offered, and for others we would like to remember, let us pray to the Lord.
Thank you.
presentation of the holy oils that are used by the priest for anointing of the sick and for the sacraments of baptism and confirmation. The bishop blesses this oil every year during Holy Week. Bishop Mambara blessed the oil on Tuesday of Holy Week at St. Peter's Cathedral in Scranton. The priests of the diocese were present for this Mass and renewed their priestly vows and commitment. Please remain seated as the holy oils are presented. We bring the oil of the sick, blessed by our bishop, for the anointing for those who suffer in mind and body. By this holy anointing, may the sick gain strength, even in their suffering. May they be released from fear and receive the consolation of faith. We bring the oil of catechumens, blessed by our bishop, for the anointing of all the infants, children, and adults who are called to prepare for baptism. By this anointing, may they receive strength to renounce sin and the glamour of evil, and so approach the waters of baptism. We bring the holy chrism, the mixture of oil and fragrant perfume, consecrated by our bishop to anoint all the baptized with the sacrament of confirmation, to anoint the presbyter's hands and the bishop's head, to anoint also the altar and all the walls of the house of the church.
Thank you.
And now pray that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries, for whenever the memorial of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts we offer you in sacrifice, and these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your Holy Catholic Church, be pleased to grant her peace, to guard you, unite and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, Joseph, our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth and on the Catholic faith and the apostolic faith, remember, Lord, your servants and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, as Lord they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and praying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. Celebrating the most sacred action in which the Lord Jesus Christ was handed over for our sake, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious Virgin Mary, Mother, Mother of our Lord, God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James and John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Mark, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all the saints. We ask you through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protection and help. Therefore, O Lord, we pray, graciously accept the oblation of our service, that your whole family, which we make to you as we observe the day on which our Lord Jesus Christ handed on the mysteries of his body and blood, for his disciples and celebrate, we celebrate, order our days in your peace, and command that we may be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering of our respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and the blood of your beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer for our salvation and the salvation of all, that is today, he took bread in his holy, venerable hands, and with eyes raised from heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
We live this bread, and drink this cup.
as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven. Of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to you glorious majesty. From the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of unending salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel, the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest, Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne to the hands of your holy angel, to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us, who through his participation at the altar, receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember, O Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and the rest in the sleep of Christ. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. We also ask your servants, who those sinners hope to, in your abandoned mercy, graciously grant that some share the fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these things good, O Lord, and sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them with, and bestow them with us. Through him, with him, and in him. O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
You say.
keep me safe for eternal life. May the blood of Christ keep me safe for eternal life.
Is wrong now.
Body of Christ. Grant, Almighty God, that just as we were renewed by the supper of your Son in this present age, so we may enjoy his banquet for all eternity, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Start our liturgy this evening by having the Eucharistic procession, the repository. But before we do that, I'd just like to thank all of you for being here. Beautiful tribute to our Lord in the Eucharist and the priesthood. And so thank you for that. And thank you for all who helped us message in it, and I'll close in. Will, our MC, and his brother is Andrew. And Andrew is a seminarian and will be ordained to the transition of the diaconate in the spring, and then please God, priesthood the following year. So that's good news. And also, Peter. Peter is a senior in high school at the moment, but after he's graduated, he's going on to the seminary to study for the priesthood. How about that? Isn't that wonderful? Let's give all these.
Good night.